What's up, everyone? Today, we have, by popular demand, Toxicroak. The Toxic Mouth Pokemon has been around since Generation 4, as players of Diamond and Pearl may remember its cheeky pre-evolution Krogunk showing up in Pastoria City, and Toxicroak itself being featured on Galactic Admin Saturn's team. Also, Brock had a Krogunk too, so that's kind of cool, I guess. Krogunk and Toxicroak's typing is entirely unique, by the way, not shared with any other Pokemon in the game. Today, we'll find out if this Poison Dart Frog was as toxic to the competitive scene as Britney Spears, or if it's simply croaked. So we ask, how good was Toxicroak actually? And in this video, we'll be going over these competitive formats. OU for Toxicroak was just a bit beyond Toxicroak's pay grade in its debut generation. It wasn't exactly bad, but there was zero reason to use it over the plethora of excellent fighting types in the tier. Infernape with its amazing speed and secondary fire stab, Breloom with spore and secondary grass stab, Lucario with its great typing and terrific priority options, and Machamp with its powerful no guard dynamic punch were all superior. Even the lesser seen choices in Heracross and Gallade had legitimate niches. Toxicroak had an awkward mix of not exactly being weak, but not exactly being an offensive powerhouse either. An issue potentially further compounded if it wanted to use a plus speed nature to get the most out of its decent but not amazing speed stat of 85. It was also quite frail and overall just couldn't hack it. So it dropped to UU, where it became an excellent offensive Pokemon. Its speed was quite solid for the tier, and it immediately threatened much of the tier's fire, water, grass, steel, or rock structure, as well as having terrific sweeping potential with Swords Dance or Nasty Plot, especially because both sets had excellent priority in Sucker Punch and Vacuum Wave, respectively. Its ability to run both sets also gave it an unpredictability factor that made it even more difficult to counter. For example, Weezing, Donphan, and Slowbro were solid checks to the Swords Dance variant, but got blown away by the Nasty Plot set. At times, Toxicroak was such a terrifying threat that Milotic would sacrifice a valuable move slot for Hidden Power Psychic. Toxicroak wasn't merely an offensive juggernaut, though. With its great resist, it could not only switch onto the battlefield so it could cause havoc offensively, but it can also pull some key defensive utility. Resisting both stabs from the tier's number one Pokemon, Venusaur, was highly useful, and absorbing toxic spikes could be key for Toxicroak's teammates, especially since not needing Venusaur for that task would allow the use of other grasses like Leafeon and Torterra. However, Toxicroak's main defensive use stemmed from its amazing ability, Dry Skin, which granted it a water immunity. It was generally useful, performing feats such as helping pivot around a surf spamming Milotic and completely blanking the monstrously powerful choice band Azumarill's Waterfall. But the best thing Toxicroak did was act as a terrific natural check to the Swift Swimmers in Rain Dance teams, which was a huge deal given how strong they were to the point of being considered overpowered by many top players. Toxicroak resisted Kabutops' secondary stab in Stone Edge and even potentially had super effective priority against it with the Vacuum Wave that Nasty Plot variants ran. Coolfish had both of its stabs resisted, and Toxicroak could switch into either Ludicolo stab, healing off damage from a grass move thanks to Dry Skin's Rain Recovery, and live a Life Orb Ice Beam, or even a Swords Dance boosted Ice Punch with health to spare. Finally, even Gorbis's mighty special attack stat couldn't quite break through with Ice Beam. Toxicroak wouldn't solo these teams or anything, but it'd be a valuable member in holding off their assault. Overall, Toxicroak was a truly excellent Pokemon in the tier that helped define it. Sure, it had issues like Move Slot Syndrome and Frailty at times, but it proved that it was one of the best choices in UU time and time again throughout the generation. And now for Gen 4 VGC. Toxicroak has got quite a few of the VGC standards going for it. Stab fighting type moves, and a smorgasbord of priority moves, from Fake Out, to Sucker Punch, to Feint, to Vacuum Wave. However, it faced competition from the likes of Hariyama, who brought more physical prowess and bulk to the table. Toxicroak's saving grace was its ability Dry Skin, which carved out a small niche for it as a Fake Out fighting type that could function especially well in Rain. It should come as no surprise then, that Toxicroak found success in VGC's early years, which were marked by the constant downpours of Ludicolo. In fact, it took home the gold medal in the very first VGC championships ever in 2009 on Kazuyuki Tsuji's Rain team. Toxicroak was arguably Tsuji's MVP in the finals at least. Its Focus Sash and Fake Out combo created guaranteed momentum that Empoleon could take advantage of with either an Icy Wind or Surf, both of which had added benefits other than damage. Icy Wind provided speed control, while Surf nourished Toxicroak's Dry Skin and let it stick around longer even if it was reduced to a single point of HP. Tsuji rounded out Toxicroak's moveset with Cross Chop for good damage input and Taunt to shut down opposing setup strategies. The next year, Toxicroak had another World's Top 8 appearance in Gen 4 once 2010's restricted meta rolled around. Credit of Ryan Deagle Beagle Chambers. Ryan used Toxicroak alongside Abomasnow, Mewtwo, Ho-Oh, Giratina, and Palkia. He fitted Toxicroak with a Life Orb as opposed to Focus Sash for additional damage input, using Toxicroak as one of the few strong physical attackers in a largely special metagame to beat Pokemon like Abomasnow, Snorlax, and Tyranitar. However, it's hard to deny that Toxicroak was punching a bit above its weight in this meta. While a nice niche pick, the 2010 strategy was to only bring two restricted Pokemon, and it faced stiff competition with Tyranitar, Abomasnow, Infernape, Togekiss, and Ludicolo. Generation 5 was all about Politoed's reign, both abusing it and keeping it in check. It was at this point Toxicroak introduced itself as something of a rain expert itself, as Dry Skin allowed it to abuse rain for longevity while dishing out an offensive assault and while checking other rain incredibly well. It could even run Life Orb and still effectively gain 2.5% of HP per each turn it attacked, as opposed to losing 10%. Or it could gain even more than that now that Drain Punch was buffed. Toxicroak had a ton of great qualities. The most obvious one was gaining HP from Specs Hydro Pump that its teammates Ferrothorn wouldn't want to eat for fear of getting worn down. Toxicroak was also a source of offense that wasn't stopped at all by Ferrothorn, which was huge for rain teams, and it mowed through Tyranitar as well. Absorbing Toxic Spikes was also incredibly useful in the fight against the ever-obnoxious Tentacruel on Rainstall. The Scald plus Toxic combination annoyed just about every Pokemon in the game, but not Toxicroak, who would often proceed to wipe out those teams nearly single-handedly, as all their members took huge damage from it and also struggled to wear it down since it healed easily in rain. Now, Toxicroak did have its flaws, as Reuniclus, Skarmory, Jellicent, and Hippowdon all gave it large amounts of trouble, and as these Pokemon all commonly featured on the increasingly popular Sandstall teams, as well as others such as Mew and faster variants of Gliscor, Toxicroak found itself walled too easily as the metagame progressed, and thus it dropped out of usage. However, when Black and White 2 rolled around, Toxicroak surged back with a vengeance. Keldeo was the new premier offensive threat, a water type with a monstrous special attack stat that sliced through Ferrothorn with ease thanks to its secondary stab in Secret Sword. It was able to either drown everything with powerful rain boosted attacks or have its few checks pursuited by Tyranitar. Toxicroak was unique in that it was immune to Keldeo's rain powered Specs Hydro Pump, resisted its Secret Sword, and dominated Tyranitar to boot. This was huge in defensive utility, and rain users jumped back on the Toxicroak train as it allowed them to turn Keldeo into an offensive assault, which no other Pokemon in the game could really do. As it turned out, Toxicroak was also a great partner for Keldeo, as the two shared a common counter in Jellicent, and Toxicroak adapted with a substitute Toxic set that utterly dominated Jellicent, allowing Keldeo to run wild. Substitute also let Toxicroak unleash a powerful Life Orb Focus Punch that cracked open even Skarmory, making it difficult to wall, especially in conjunction with Ice Punch for Gliscor and the newly introduced Landorus Therion. Toxicroak taking advantage of the Tentacruel that would slow Keldeo down was also incredibly useful. Overall, Toxicroak was a solid OU Pokemon in Gen 5 and is one of the best examples of a Pokemon that thrived in the weather metagame. Gen 5's influx of fighting types was just as harmful to Toxicroak in VGC as it was in singles. Toxicroak's role as a fakeout using fighting type was under heavy pressure. Both Scrafty and Hitmontop came with superior typing, bulk, and the incredible boon of Intimidate, making whatever pressure Toxicroak could offer nearly obsolete. Even if you didn't want to pack fakeout onto your fighting type, Toxicroak's middling speed tier was actually a huge harm to it. It's nowhere near fast enough to function as a sweeper, but it's not slow enough to be a top tier Trick Room attacker either, especially when you consider the likes of Conkeldurr and Hariyama. Toxicroak's only notable Gen 5 placement came in 2013, when Rob Whitehill paired it with its amphibian brethren in Politoed to place top 8 at the Australian National Championships. Rob went all in on rain, including Scizor, Tornadus, and two Storm Drain Pokemon in Gastrodon and Maractus. With three Pokemon that benefited from being hit by water type moves, Rob could send out Politoed and shout Surf's Up. However, Toxicroak was still a lower tier rain Pokemon when compared to Ludicolo or Kingdra, at least in doubles, and Rob's top 8 placement was the only notable result it had. Weather was no longer permanent in Generation 6, which, alongside the major Mega Field power creep, officially ended Toxicroak's tenure in OU, sending it back to its original home of UU. And it still had some solid traits down there. The first being it was a fighting type that didn't care at all about fairy types, thanks to its brutal stab gunk shot, if it actually hit. And second, it was not stopped in the slightest by the bane of offensive Pokemon everywhere, Alomomola. Being able to blank most Suicunes was incredibly useful as well. But the good traits ended there though. Apart from the issue of not being able to fit every move it'd like to, which was absolutely huge, the main problem was Toxicroak's frailty and inability to accomplish much against offensive teams, which were a lot faster, stronger, and even bulkier than the last time it'd seen UU play two generations prior. Teams filled with Pokemon like Crobat, Entei, Shaymin, Crocodile, Mien Shao, and Swampert not only were tough for Toxicroak to switch in against, but were also tough for it to leave any major damage on without both exceptional prediction and having to sacrifice itself in the process. Stall teams packing Pokemon like Cresselia, Dualblade, Nidoqueen, and Gligar didn't make Toxicroak's job too easy either. A good player could get some heavy damage out of Toxicroak with good team support, aggressive playing, and a decent team matchup, but those were rather strenuous requirements, so most of the time Toxicroak was more passed over for more consistent offensive Pokemon. It didn't help that Infernape, a seriously difficult Pokemon to compete with, was in the tier as well. It's not that Toxicroak was a bad Pokemon, it just was not in too great an environment for it to succeed. It had it even rougher in that it was used just enough to make it ineligible to drop to RU, where it likely would have been a fine Pokemon. And speaking of which, Gen 7's power creep was finally sufficient to knock Toxicroak down to RU, where it settled in nicely as a solid overall threat. It was really tough to wall, especially since it could bait in and destroy Slowbro, Cresselia, and Mandibuzz, expecting the Life Orb set with a Swords Dance boosted Acid Downpour, and could grab that Swords Dance easily since it threatened common defensive staples like Registeel and Milotic. Speaking of Milotic, Dry Skin was useful in giving Toxicroak swish-in opportunities as it fully abused Araquanid, as well as the aforementioned Milotic. Toxicroak's auspicious typing gave it further defensive utility against some dangerous offensive threats such as Virizion, certain Roserade, and with careful play, Mega Blastoise. Some players even made use of a Choice Scarf Toxicroak, which allowed it to blitz through offensive teams that relied on outspeeding it with Pokemon like Salazzle and Zygarde 10%. The Scarf also allowed Toxicroak to check them as well as generally being good against most offensive Pokemon, making for a better all-around Toxicroak in the offensive matchup. It obviously wasn't threatening to break any walls, but it still had utility against defensive teams thanks to knockoff. Scarf was also unique because it was a set none of the other fighting types in the tier, like Virizion, Machamp, Sock, and Pangoro, were able to pull off, whereas they were able to give Swords Dance Toxicroak legitimate competition for a lot since they were similarly effective on offense. However, overall, Toxicroak was a strong, unique Pokemon in Gen 7 RU. Toxicroak laid low in Gen 6, where the prevalence of Talonflame, Salamence, and Groudon throughout different formats made running it a very scary proposition. Certain popular sets completely nullified Toxicroak. Bronzong, for example, both walled it and could let Kyogre beat it by skill swapping Dry Skin away. Toxicroak's diminished popularity continued into most of Gen 7 VGC, outclassed as it was by other physical attackers and fighting types. However, Toxicroak made a triumphant return in VGC 2019, when the popularity of Kyogre allowed Toxicroak to rehydrate and creep back into competition, as it both benefited immensely from rain and walled Kyogre completely. Toxicroak thus had an extremely potent role. Simply by being on the team, you improved your Kyogre matchup tenfold. Toxicroak also had some okay matchups against the rest of the field, as the prevalence of Xerneas meant Toxicroak's poison typing could finally be useful as opposed to simply making it extra vulnerable to psychic Pokemon. Toxicroak's typing also let it obliterate opposing Tapus and potentially have a shot to deal heavy damage to the demon known as Incineroar. Take a look at the Pokemon we just mentioned and try to figure out what they have in common. If the answer is they don't need Z-moves or Mega Evolution to be good, you're correct. Toxicroak thrived in the strange metagame of the Sun series, where it was able to utilize its good typing matchup against the top Pokemon of the format, but without having to worry about the additional power that could blow it away. Toxicroak's moveset was built around this. It most commonly carried an Assault Vest to tank Xerneas's Moonblast, with its moveset commonly being Poison Jab, Low Kick, Fake Out, and Faint. If you wanted more general power, Gunk Shot was an option, and Low Sweep could provide good utility. But perhaps its most notable alternative move was Sucker Punch, which could potentially obliterate opposing Lunala with proper prediction. Without Sucker Punch, Lunala was one of the biggest counters to Toxicroak, capable of shattering it with powerful psychic moves. Other problems included Groudon, Yveltal, and Tapu Lele, but the Kyogre focus of the Sun series let Toxicroak shine even through the rain. Toxicroak was by no means a staple of the Sun series, but it was was still a threatening niche pick that could easily improve a team's Kyogre matchup while giving Fake Out support. The dual Justins, Justin Burns and Justin Cabral, took 1st and 7th respectively at the Philadelphia Regionals with the team they crafted together consisting of Kyogre, Yveltal, Incineroar, Tapu Lele, and Stakataka alongside Toxicroak. Justin Burns later used the same squad to place 8th at the Portland Regionals, where Louis Malich also used his own different Kyogre Toxicroak team to place 2nd. Toxicroak's biggest wins, however, came via a different pair of players, the constant innovators of Ashton Cox and Jeremy Rodriguez. They proved the power of their joint team by taking the top prizes at the Memphis Regionals, facing off in a mirror match in the finals with their team of Smeargle, Xerneas, Incineroar, Lunala, Crobat, and Toxicroak. They then went to Brazil for a repeated performance at the Latin America International Championships, where Ashton took 1st place again and Jeremy finished 3rd behind James Bay. Said tournament also featured Ethan French's Toxicroak team, featuring the Kyogre Lele core that the Justins had used earlier. Toxicroak's success continued into the Moon Series. While Z-Crystals could nominally give it an offensive presence and the power to KO Xerneas, the Moon Series actually saw Toxicroak use a different, familiar item more frequently, Focus Sash. While it didn't have any wins quite as high profile as its Sun Series resume, Toxicroak was still a frequent visitor to the regional top cuts. Aaron Traylor finished 3rd with it at Dallas, and Alan Martinez and Alex Aran took it to 3rd and 4th at Collinsville. Toronto Regionals featured 2 Toxicroak players in top 8, with James Evan taking 4th and Alvin Hidayat finishing 7th. Alvin Hidayat also finished 5th at Greensboro with Toxicroak, where Alan Martinez used it again to place 8th, and Brian Yum ended in 4th. Rounding up the regional events, Henry Rich gave Toxicroak a 2nd place at the Perth Regionals, where Christopher Kahn also placed 5th with the Frog. Finally, Liam Gilbert gave Toxicroak another round of Oceanic fame when he finished 5th at the Oceania International Championship. However, the Ultra Series was not kind to Toxicroak. With Mega Rayquaza and Mega Salamence unleashed, Toxicroak now had a huge arsenal of threats to stare down. What's more, Ultra Necrozma was an entirely new threat to deal with. But maybe the biggest problem, though, was the reintroduction of the blue and red orbs. Primal Groudon surged back to the top of usage with red orb available, making Toxicroak's life very hard. But Primal Kyogre had a better matchup against Toxicroak too. Because Primordial Seed deactivates when Kyogre is switched out, a smart Kyogre player could nip Toxicroak's healing in the bud by switching it out, effectively negating the one niche it had as a strong Kyogre answer. As a result, Toxicroak shriveled up once more, sadly disappearing almost entirely from the Ultra Series. 2019 was a good showcase for the very specific strengths of Toxicroak in a rain-heavy metagame, but unless there's a downpour going, it simply doesn't have the resources to be a good Pokemon. And that's it! So how good was Toxicroak actually? Well, it's truly one of a kind, with a litany of unique traits coming together to form a Pokemon like no other. And that's fueled its solid viability in 3 out of the 4 generations it's been in, with it being a legitimate OU threat and one of them to boot. It had its ups and downs in VGC, as it's certainly flawed, but its positive traits have brought many trainers many wins. Overall, Toxicroak has been quite a fine Pokemon, and is likely to carry on as one in Generation 8. Hopefully. Like many decent Pokemon, if Game Freak allows it, Toxicroak is able to bring new skills to the table each generation in order to keep up with the new power creep. Now granted, it couldn't do it every generation, as evident by how it did in Gen 7, at least in the singles meta. If only it had Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community where millions come together to push themselves to learn new skills that are important to them. Skillshare has thousands of classes covering dozens of creative and entrepreneurial skills, the teachers of course being experts in their fields themselves. As some of you may know, my forte in creative work is video editing, but I've always wanted to expand that skill set further into visual effects, specifically with 3D modeling. Thanks to Skillshare, I was able to become proficient enough to, I know Magnemite is made out of simple shapes, but making this Magnemite from scratch helped me learn the basics of the program so I'm at least not lost anymore, and I would have been completely lost otherwise if not for Skillshare's myriad of classes on Blender. Now I'm doing this motion graphic class involving Cinema 4D, another 3D modeling program, by Gustavo Torres, and I'm just super happy I finally made myself take this next step in increasing my stats in creativity. I want 2020 to be the year of creative improvement and taking real steps towards that improvement instead of trying 2020 New Year's resolutions for like a week and then dropping it. And I want you, the viewer, to be able to share this exploration with me. So what are you waiting for? Go to this link on screen or click on it in the description down below to start your free trial. The first 500 people who click on this link will get premium Skillshare for free for 2 months. And after that, the yearly subscription comes to just under $10 a month. Thanks for watching, everyone. And as always, if you like the video and you want to see more, be sure to subscribe to False Swipe Gaming for more weekly Pokemon content. And in the comments, I want to know, what do you think about competitive Toxicroak? Would you change it to make it so that it can function outside of rain? Whatever it is, let me know in the comments. Also, thank you so much to our patrons for continued support of our videos. And thank you to everyone else watching as well. And follow my crew on these social media platforms. And that's all I got. See you next time, everyone.